Most people remember their lives through a collection of photographs, but I tend to relive mine through my models. So I picked up this small piece of perspex from the broken cockpit of the Spitfire and proceeded to carve a model from it. And I suppose this is the beginning of my career in model making. The first one was very much a feeling that I've got to build this ship model. I've got to get this out of my system by building one. And I really did think that once I had built one, that would probably be it. But something in me said, you can do better than that, so build another one and another and another. And here we are, 440 something later. I have the largest collection of model warships made entirely of matchsticks and matchboxes in the whole world. I've been making these models since 1948, which is 62 years at the moment. I've built well over 400, but my existing fleet's 338. I think it's a love of the miniature. I just love miniature things, whether I've made the models or I'm just looking at them. I have to confess, I sometimes look at it when I've just displayed them and think, have I really done this? It's because everybody says, how many people have built all these, you know? It's just little me. Quite accidentally, I've built a history of warships in the last 60 years. Anita, bless her, knew nothing about warships at all. One of the very touching things is that towards the end of her life, when she was still with me at shows, and she would pick up the demo model, and I would see her at the corner explaining to people how I had done this and done that. And I know very well she could scarcely see what she was looking at. Congratulations, Mr. Warren, you've got a son, 5.5 weeks early. I didn't need telling which was Nigel. I knew instantly. I could see my father there. And I knew instantly, there was no doubt about it, that's Nigel, you know. Buying Nigel the nicest, poshest pedal car you could ever imagine when he's about 3 or 4. Top of the range stuff, and he spent the rest of Christmas Day playing in the box and not in the car. And that, I understand, is perfectly normal. Yeah. But it's a lovely memory, isn't it? You know, there's this posh pedal car in the corner of the room, and the box he's sitting in is a spaceship or something, you know. Children's imagination's a wonderful thing. Obviously, he was the apple of her eye, and Nigel could do no wrong in her eyes, which must be universal, mustn't it? The young lady that he married is exceptionally nice as well. I mean, just being down there to them for Christmas Day and so on. And, very pleased with what he's done and what he's made of his life. It's just one of those things that long before I started even dreaming of displaying them, I was just building them for fun. And as they started to get better, I thought, well, I'm just piling up these models that aren't too good. Nigel, like any child, was full of war games and always picking up the model and sort of bombing the ships and that. And so having a nice big garden in those days, we took a few of them out the back and quietly put a lit match under a couple of them, and we just watched them burn, you know. And Nigel, great squeals of delight from Nigel, of course. I'm sure Nigel can remember the occasions, because he was always saying, haven't we got another one, we can burn that, you know. One of the ways of meeting people then, as I suppose now, was going to dances and socials and things like that. This other young lady worked for us, and a whole bunch of us from work went to dances together. And at one of these dances, she introduced me to her younger sister, and that was that. I think we both knew almost instantly that that was it, you know. We'd always dreamt of owning our own house in France. And when we finally found one in Duracells near Poitiers, we were so excited. It was exactly the way we had always pictured our second home. We should have done it years ago. Having waited all those years to do it, and sadly Nita died just soon after we bought it. She only went there twice. But I kept it on for another 5 or 6 years and made some great friends, but the magic had gone, obviously, without my wife. I clearly knew for probably 5, even more years, that Nita was not going to outlive me. Anyone who knows anything about diabetes know that it is a killer. You could see her daily getting worse. You get to the point where eventually she is getting so bad that you sort of wonder, for her sake, whether life's worth living. We were off to France the following week, and I took her down to a renal clinic. And they said, oh, we've got to keep her in, there's things going wrong. The doctor himself said, well, you know, you go, as long as we can get in touch. Nigel came with me. We'd only been over there about 3 days, and I get a phone call in the middle of the night saying, can we get back as quickly as possible? So we jumped in the car, and Nigel drove all through the night back up to Cherbourg. And the doctor said, there's no other way of saying it. I'm afraid Nita won't last till the weekend. And he was absolutely right, because she passed away on the next day. That was like being poleaxed. I'd like to think she didn't know how ill she was. I think she just literally went to sleep. I proposed to Anita sitting on our favourite bench on the Milldown, where we walked so often and is one of our favourite spots, looking out over certainly one of my favourite views. Anita was very much the love of my life. I still obviously miss her greatly.